10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Most scariest night of the week, and I'm super excited. Come on, you guys, let's go. There was a part in the movie where was could hurt her, and I screamed out, "See!" And then everyone. Day three is done. Day four is tomorrow. We gotta go. Day three of the Portland Horror Film Festival. It is Friday, so it's gonna be the most scariest night of the week, and I'm super excited. Come on, you guys, let's go.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, everyone.
Oh my God, you made it to Friday night. It's Friday. You can stay all night. I mean, that won't be that much different than the other nights, but hopefully you don't have to go to work tomorrow morning. Who was here for the first time tonight? All right, good. Well, this is the third out of six shows, and we're almost to the halfway point. Halfway point!
First, I want to tell you, tomorrow, the horror continues at the Clinton Street Theater with a show that starts at noon. We're just doing a matinee tomorrow, but it is our double feature of Horror by Women, along with Schultz Boss. We have two features, Stag by Alexandra Spieth, who is here with us tonight, and she'll be there for Q&A afterwards tomorrow. More amazing short films, and then we also have Maya by KXI, who is the writer and director, and she will also be with us all the way from London, coming in to see the film with us and do a Q&A afterwards. And then no show Saturday night, because we wanted to give you guys the night off, because we love you.
You need some time off.
And we needed some time off, but we will be hitting up Dots right after the Saturday matinee. Around 5 o'clock we'll be getting out, so we'll have some drinks, some food, and get to talk over at Dots afterwards.
They have some fun horror-themed cocktails created for us.
Right. And then on Sunday afternoon, we are going to be back at the Clinton Street Theater at noon, from noon to 4. And that is our short extravaganza of another amazing block of short films, followed by a Q&A with the filmmakers. And then we have the extreme Italian horror film called Naughty Morti afterwards.
Which is, if you love sort of transgressive, violent, bloody, giallo films, you want to see Naughty Morti, because it's awesome, and it will leave a mark.
Just to give you a glimpse, it is about a young woman who's an embalmer and a taxidermist, and she's obsessed with all things death. And one day, she takes a walk in the forest to see if she can find any little animals or birds to do some more taxidermy with, and stumbles across a dead woman and a not-quite-dead man. to find out what happens. Come on, Sunday.
It's not good for anybody. It's not a nice ending for any of the people involved. But then on Sunday night, we're back here at the Hollywood Theater, and please do not miss Sunday night. That's our closing night of the festival. And it's our double-double closing night mini-movie marathon. Double-double closing night mini-movie marathon. Yeah, that's what it is. And that's two short film blocks and two features. We're going to start with some great short films, several of them from Northern Europe. And then we'll go straight into a feature film, The Parker Sessions,
yes,
directed by Stephen King Simmons. And Stephen King Simmons will be here for a Q&A. So yeah, don't miss that. That's a really cool, gritty, psychological horror film. And then our infamous Shorts Gone Wild block, which you guys have probably been inundated with the trailer here. Slideshow's not that long, so it loops quite a bit. And that's an amazing block of just the craziest, goriest, funniest short films of the whole festival, including some of my local filmmakers who will be here for a Q&A afterwards. So don't miss that. We love to show stuff like that on closing night because it's sort of a palate cleanser to take all the darkness out and just replace it with just like lots and lots of blood. Which that's
a transfusion of sorts.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we all drink blood, right? That's normal. So, just me, I guess.
It's Portland, they all drink IPA.
And then we'll be closing with our closing night feature, It Hatched, which is an awesome, quirky folk horror comedy from Iceland. It's so fun, it's so cool, it's weird and dark, there's penises. I'm just telling you about the movie. but it's great, don't miss that. That's our closing night feature, and you know, we're very, very careful when we pick our opening night features and our closing night features, and we try to do everything just right all the way through the festival. So please come back for Sunday night to see what we end with.
Definitely. But first, tonight, we have an amazing, incredible block of the scariest short films of the festival. And this includes two world premieres, Shadow of a Silhouette by Jason Affolder, who unfortunately was planning on coming but couldn't be with us this weekend due to a family emergency. But he is a second-time filmmaker in the Portland Horror Film Festival. His previous short was Way Station, which I think streamed in the 2020 festival, and that was the 2020. So if any of you watched that, that was the one with the girl, the late-night desk clerk at the motel that checks people in. And then the other world premiere tonight is In the Shadow of God by Brian Zemanczyk, who was one of the winners of our best shorts back in, I think, 2017. And he is here with us tonight, along with the lead actress, and they'll be here for Q&A afterwards. And we also have the U.S. premiere of a really amazing film called Love You, Mama, starring Madeline Arthur from Colorado Space. You may remember that. And then stick around for the Q&A after the shorts. And then we're going to send you off into the evening with another handful of shorts and the incredible Canadian Sylvan horror, Woodland Grey by Adam Brager.
Be sure to stick around for that. That's a creepy, crazy movie. All right.
That's all I got. Let's watch some movies.
With that, let's watch some movies. Let's go.
So it's a scary block, right?
Yes.
I was not lying, was I? No? Maybe a little. Nobody. Nobody was scared? I mean, I was here. I heard something. So on stage here, we've got Brian Zemanczyk. Those of you that were here a few years ago, you may have seen his film Compulsion.
Yes.
It was a very, very dark slasher film.
Yes, yes.
And that won our best short that year.
Yep.
Right?
No, yes.
Yeah. He brought his friend, oh my God, I was going to screw it up. Sarah, who was the lead in The Shadow of God. And we also have Chris here, who's one of the, yeah, let's give him a round of applause. Chris, who was one of the producers on Love You, Mama.
Mm-hmm. There we go. going.
Oh, we're live. Oh, thank you. That sounds good. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Hey, before we get started, I want a round of applause for Brian and Gwen for putting on another great festival. You guys kill it every time. It's amazing.
Thank you. We appreciate it.
Oh, for sure. We appreciate you.
So let's get started with In the Shadow of God. Uh-huh. I love all the little... Well, anybody here probably knows I'm like a super fan of any witch kind of, I'm just like an occult horror fiend. And I loved all the little, you know, Easter eggs in there, like the book that references, you know, that suggests the witch trials in this city. Yeah. Was this meant to be a kind of Salem, or did that not cross your mind? Or is this a real place?
Yeah, well, it's fictional, but yeah, it's essentially, you know, dealing with, you know, generational trauma that you deal with, you know, with your own family, but also mirrored with the Salem witch trials type thing, and how that plays into a family addiction, and, you know, so yes. If not Salem, I don't know, it was made up, it's fictional, but close enough.
Did you have a notion that maybe you were gonna do like a Salem, but you decided that was maybe too obvious or something?
I love living in the Pacific Northwest, and I love shooting there, so it's like, let's keep it in the Pacific Northwest, make it creepy there. Because it's beautiful,
sure.
Right?
Yeah. All the stuff in the woods, and that sort of wall of trees,
mm-hmm.
just all by itself is so creepy, even without the sort of root cellar right there that goes down, and who knows where.
Yeah, exactly. It's, I mean, just point the camera anywhere in the Pacific Northwest, and it's either creepy or beautiful. Yeah, depending on what kind of music you put underneath it.
Where did you film it?
We shot on the Sunshine Coast. So we're from Vancouver, Canada, BC, beautiful British Columbia. Yeah.
Me too, just for the record.
Really?
Yeah.
No way.
Oh, that's awesome.
So yeah, the Sunshine Coast, you have to ferry you over there.
Thanks.
Yeah, that's what we get. But yeah, it's this really beautiful, kind of desolate, it's not huge population out there, and we found an Airbnb that was nice enough to let us film a horror movie there, which was insane, because we had to be like, hey, we want to stay here for a couple days.
Did you actually tell them, or did you just like shoot it on the...
We told them, we're like...
I've done it before where we just rented it, and we're like, yeah, well, if they see it, we'll
see it. I don't think they would see this, but yeah, I was worried about that, but I was like, we should be up front, because there's a lot of blood, you know, people.
Witchcraft, and, you know.
Yeah. Dark Satan shit. But when they were cool, they're like, yeah, how about an extra $10 a day? We're like, oh my god. Yeah. Great. I should have fought them on that. I should be like, come on. $10.
Did you leave all of the, you know, the child's handprints on the window?
I can't remember actually. They might still be there. And also we didn't tell them we were digging that cellar, so I don't know if that's still there. By the way, you're going walking at the end of your driveway.
All that stuff was so creepy. All of that build-up and the handprints, that was a great touch. Like, first time I saw that, you know, I think we were watching on the computer, and I was like, what am I looking at? Like, oh, are those handprints, like, on the outside of the glass, you know? And, like I said, the book, and then, you know, that creepy symbol that was kind of floating around everywhere. Where did that come from?
That was actually our art director, Courtney, who's amazing. She found that online. She was looking, trying to find a little pagan symbolism. So she found that one that actually represents banishment. So it was really fitting to use that and just have a cool symbol, a cool theme to play throughout the film. So.
So I mentioned this to you earlier in the lobby. Compulsion, one of the things that really grabbed me about it was the sound design. You want to talk a little bit about the sound work in this film?
Yeah, we had, we spent a lot of time in post. And me and my friend Nick, who's also here, we worked on the music together, and that was a huge component, just to kind of drive the mood. I don't know if you guys listen to heavy music, but Nick plays in the band called Baptist and Sumac. Yeah, he plays a bunch of stuff, he's really good. So I was lucky to have him. But yeah, that was, you know, as with any film, it's just such a big component. We spent many months on that, so I'm happy to know. Well,
how the six channel sound? That sound okay to you?
Yeah, it was cool. I noticed one of the speakers were rattling during a little bit, so I hope we didn't damage anything. But that's also kind of cool.
Now, for you, being the sort of the woman beset by all of this, what was it like having to kind of live through? I mean, this is a super super tense, stressful, dramatic piece. How did you prepare for that? You know, to just get ready to be that sort of ripped apart by a movie.
What did I do? I don't remember. I think the funny thing about this film was it was like summer camp. It was so, we were all tucked away in a very isolated place, and everybody was just so great and so willing to make this film together. Like, it just really, it was really fun, and I don't remember being in any mental stress at all. I don't know. Just did it, I guess. Just like, I work mostly with like body, like I just tuck things away in different body centers. So I think it was just all, you know, the horror of the situation and of, I mean, I think we all understand family trauma a smidge, maybe. That's all in all of us somewhere. So I really don't remember it being stressful at all. It was really fun.
It was cool because I remember asking you, I was like, do you want to rehearse anything before? You're like, no, let's just get out there, so, because I'm going to let it out.
I don't remember that either.
Yeah, it was cool. Sarah's good. She's just good.
So you just blocked it all out. That's what happened.
I guess.
So I
remember that stuff. We shot the stuff in the in the cellar last on our last day.
Yeah.
With the baby and both of us, you know, being quite upset. Adam Mollicker, who's great in the film, and then we wrapped and sort of all sat around quietly eating pizza. Like, you were so good to order us pizza, and we all just and we were just like.
I was like, we're done. I was like, this is so sick. You guys did a great job. And they were so still coming from the scene of like, this child is maybe not living in. Everyone was just like, ugh. It was such a funny scene. Yeah. It's like some pizza.
Pizza fixes really a lot of things. Now, Chris, let's talk a little bit about Love You Mama. Now you're a producer, so I won't ask any of these sort of the directory kind of questions, but talk a little bit about Madeline Arthur and Samantha Sloyd, because they really, I mean, they carry the entire piece, and you know, it only works because they're both amazing. How did that come about? How did that kind of casting come about?
Yeah, they are both fucking fantastic, like just knocked it out of the park. Super impressive what they can do. Alex, the director, who wanted to be here but couldn't, she's the assistant to my clinic. So she, you know, we're all in Vancouver, like, working on this shit, and she's with Sam every day, so they became best friends. And then I think she met Madeline through some film party, I don't know. But was like, hey, I'm thinking of shooting this short. I've got this role. Would you be interested in it? And she was, and did it for like nothing. And Sam also literally did it for nothing. And so I think it's just like, it's all networking, right? It's like you get connections and you get to know people. And I don't know, you get them coffee one day on set, and then they're like, yeah, sure, I'll come for the weekend and shoot your film. So yeah, that was it. And yeah, just both brilliant.
Now, those of you that are credits watchers might have noticed that Mike Flanagan edited the film. So it's a fellow that made Midnight Mass and Haunting of Bly Manor and Haunting of Hill House. Do you guys like those shows?
Yeah.
And you guys all are working together on one of his projects, right?
Yeah, I don't, actually. So Alex is his assistant, and then Connor and Cole, the other two producers, are working in the production office on his stuff for the last 2 years. I know Connor through other Vancouver film stuff because it's all one big family. Everyone just knows everyone. But yeah, they were just like, Connor came to me with the script. He was like, hey, you know, my ex-assistant has this thing that she wants to make. I think it's pretty good. And I was like, okay, well, let's see it. Let's do it. And then he actually, Mike wasn't originally planning to edit it. We had LA editors, but we didn't have a lot of money, so we were just gonna like, you know, throw them a little bit of cash, but they were gonna do their main jobs kind of full-time and then work on our stuff whenever they had time. But their main job just kept like taking forever, and we were getting a scene here and there. And then one day Alex was complaining to Mike, and he's like, well, why don't you just come in on Saturday and we'll fucking bang it out and it'll be done. We were like, oh, okay, well, you know, if Mike Flanagan wants to edit our short, I guess, you know, I'm gonna say no to that. So that was it. It's like we went into the studio on like Saturday morning, and he just sat there and like pounded it out, and then was like, okay, that's it's done. We're like, great.
Nah,
it's
super
great.
Wow. Yeah. Awesome. It's good. Good to have good friends. Yeah. Now this is, we talked a little bit about this last night. This is not a pandemic film, but it's kind of a pandemic film, at least like in terms of what we're bringing to it. I think this sort of like, you know, you just, at some point we got to go outside, honey, you know?
Yeah, it's funny. It's like, I think, I mean, I don't want to speak for Alex because it's her project and she wrote the script like ages before COVID. And I've been kind of kicking the idea around for a while. And then it just, yeah, we actually shot it a year ago this weekend because it was Canada Day long weekend, which it is today. And so it was like, yeah, we shot it during COVID. Everyone was masked and we went through all the protocols we had to do. But I don't think she ever planned it that way. And we shot it in one house because it was like easy to do one location and a few actors, and we just pile all the gear and do it, whatever. Like, didn't even really think about it being COVID. But then since we've been showing it to everyone, everyone's like, oh, it's such a metaphor for like how it felt when we were all locked down. And I guess it is, but like that, I don't think that was ever the intention. It just kind of like worked out in the timing of, you know, people went through that and then saw this thing and were like, oh yeah, it is kind of, you know, that's what people bring to it, like you were saying.
So when you guys filmed it though, did you have to have like compliance officers and stuff there?
Yeah, everyone got tested and we had like, but anyway, this is the other thing of like, because they work on Mike Flanagan and stuff, we have access to all of that like big studio connections. So it was like, everyone got their COVID test and everyone had like, you know, all the, whatever we had to do was all kind of Netflix paid for it without knowing, so it was great.
Thanks Netflix.
Set deck and like art and all. Yeah.
Oh, that's why they're
having all right now. Yeah,
so that's why they have all those layoffs now. Yeah. Oh man, that's cool. They're probably not watching. I'm sure you're okay.
Yeah.
Well, we should probably get to wrapping up. We never have much time for these onstage Q&As. I'm gonna have each of you sort of just give me one interesting story, kind of about the film, maybe. And then tell us where we can find you, or what you're working on next, and where we can find you on social media.
Oh boy.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, something.
If you find me on the lobby, I've got some cards where you can kind of scan and follow us on the socials. Yeah, that was pretty good. we're working on, what am I working on next? Anything with Sarah, if she's available and willing, and that's 100% what we're going to do. Interesting story. I mean, there's too many stories. Oh, man. we were filming on Sunshine Coast, and there was a lot of things went wrong every day, as they do.
The motel. The guy.
Oh, my
was
God.
There something
yeah.
crazy at the motel?
Yeah. So we'd have, I was trying to put everyone up at various motels in a small town, so. But the guy was hammered. So when they
the
tried
guy
to,
who owned it, who ran
the
motel.
He's run the front desk, yeah. So everyone that went to go check in their hotel is like, hey, guy at the front desk doesn't know like what's going on. He doesn't have a reservation. And I'm like, what? So I put him on the phone, he's like, hey dude, like, I don't know, do you guys need a hotel room? Like, we're full. I'm like, no, we got reservations, you're good to go. He's like, don't know, they're gonna probably have to stay with like someone else. That's I'm like,
this what? Is like middle of nowhere. Like there aren't just other places yeah. to stay.
It's like desolate. It was midnight. You know, the crew just wants to be like, please, I just want to get into bed. I want to sleep. This guy was hammered. He's talking about opening other people's rooms and like, if they're okay with it, like they can sleep with someone else. I'm like, dude, don't open up anyone else's room. Anyways, it's, the power went out one morning in the whole island. Like, too many stories.
Yeah, boy. No, the whole weekend was one big story. What am I working on? I don't know what I'm allowed to say.
Sarah's working on, like, legit stuff.
No!
what was that series?
There's a filmmaker here whose film I'm in. Am I allowed to talk about it? It's called... Am I allowed to talk about it, Kurt? Yeah, it's called Influencer. It'll be out. It's a great like adventure thriller. It's by the makers of Superhost.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
So that's exciting, and it was a really wild film to be in. So
yes,
that will be out soon.
Awesome. Woo.
And Sarah got to work with Barbara Crampton on Superhost, which is cool.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Because that's so sweet.
Yeah,
Barbara was there in that
theater. Yes, and you met her.
Oh, is that the same year?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So she was here for the host, and anyways, it was cool.
Oh, that's right. Were you, because you come a little late, which put you on stage with her.
That's right.
Do the Q&A? Yeah, that's right.
And I was like, Barbara, stay on stage with me. Everyone's going to leave if you leave.
I actually hate social media and feel a little bit vindicated by No Filter because I felt like that's an upgrade since I've been. But I think Alex has Twitter and Instagram. You should follow her because she's great. Yeah, I don't know. We're trying to get this made into a feature-length version. I think there'll be a few more things added to it. But yeah, that's our goal.
Any Hail Marys, any last things you guys want to say before I usher these Canadians off the stage?
I think it's amazing just seeing people in the theater again, so thanks everybody for coming out.
Yeah,
that was awesome to watch this with all of you. And thanks again to Canada. And yeah, thanks to you and the crew at Portland Horror Film Festival. You guys always put on a great festival. This theater is awesome.
Thank you so much.
So we just got home from day three of the Portland Horror Film Festival. And so one of the things that I have been doing from day one is I forget that I am not at home reviewing films in my own home in the privacy of by myself. So tonight when we were watching the feature film Woodland Gray, there was a part in the movie where the girl finally realizes what the guy was telling her was true and the other thing that was in the woods could hurt her, and I screamed out, "See?" And then everyone in the movie theater jumped and started laughing, and Callie was like, "What?" Like, she didn't think it was funny because I scared her to fucking death.
She
but, like,
fucking did. I clutched her arm like I was clutching my Sunday pearls, and my soul left my goddamn body.
I forget, but, like, I'm so submerged. Like, this is what I do. So, day three is done. Day four is tomorrow. We gotta go to bed. It's 2:00 in the morning. Love you guys. Ciao. Hello, peeps. So today was day three of the Portland Horror Film Festival, and we had an amazing block of fucking shorts. And when they said it was the scariest night so far, they were not kidding. So I'm going to get into this really quick because there's a lot of shorts to get through. And we also have a feature to get through as well. So they opened the short. Each day they have like this really quick flash fiction that kind of like lets everybody know that the show is about to start. And this one was called Horror in the Bedroom. So we have this kid who's waking up. He's kind of like droggy. And then he hears this horrible noise and he sees this red light under the bedroom door. And so he comes back up the steps and he's like hearing like these weird noises out of his parents' bedroom. And he opens the door and he's like, "No, Mom, Dad, that's gross." And then it has like the Portland Horror Film Festival logo. And then that's what kicks off the show. So that wasn't really scary, but the first short that kicked it off Well, it kind of was. It was an animated feature, and it was about a poor little girl who was looking into the window of a high-end clothing store, and the mannequins began to dance and sing and invite her into the store, and they had her try on these nice, fine clothes, and they're like, we know you can't afford it, but you know what? We can see it in your heart that you want these things. Just take what you want, right? So this little girl is putting on fine dresses, and she's putting on these fine shoes, and she's taking the jewelry off of the mannequin, but it does come at a price, because at the end of the movie, she becomes a mannequin, and the closing of the movie, it says, now has children's sizes, and this little girl has now lost her autonomy, and she is now a mannequin in the window. So that was a really good short, and that got a 5-star. That was like really good, really just like chilling. I kind of saw what was getting ready to happen, but she was a child, so she didn't see the dangers and what they were offering her. So then the next short that was next was called In the Shadow of a Silhouette. And this one was really absolutely chilling. So it tells a story about a woman who is driving home at night one night, late at night, after leaving the bar, and her car stalls under a street lamp. So she gets out and she sees a memorial across the street, and she goes and she looks at it, and they have like a bike and a picture of this guy who is being memorialized at that location. And then she feels someone behind her, like she feels this presence behind her, and she turns around and there's no one there. But she's feeling like really like she's being followed. So she gets in the car, she races home, and she is being followed. She's being followed by the spirit of the man who was ran over and killed in the street. And he actually possesses her body and takes over, so that he's, you know, taking over her body so that she can look at things on the internet, and he's giving her clues that she can see through his eyes. And through the movie, she solves the she solves his crime, and she gives the gift that he was going to give his girlfriend on the night that he was killed. She was able to give it to her, because, you know, it was going to be her gift, and he didn't make it to her because he was killed, and his crime went unsolved. And so that was a 5. It was really chilling the way that he took over her body. And there was a scene in the movie where he completely like took over, like, you know, up until that point, until they found who killed him, he was just like inhabiting her body, like tiny moments at a time. But when she found who ran him over and left him there to die, he completely took over her body, and he was trying to kill this guy. And she was like, please don't make me kill him. Like, if you care about Miriam, don't do this. She would think that you are a monster. And he does let her go. And the guy ends up turning himself in, because he's like, this is the devil, right? He sees that she's being possessed, but he doesn't know what she's possessed by. So In the Shadow of a Silhouette was amazing. 5 stars. So following In the Shadow of a Silhouette was a short terrifying movie called I'll Be Back Tomorrow. And this is a story about a couple who bought a house. The woman wasn't really happy about buying the house, because the reason the house was for sale was because the woman died in the house. But she had a dream about what really happened in the house, and it is much more terrifying than what the realtor and her husband let on. But the way that they shot this film is like, when she was talking about her dream, when she was telling her husband about the dream, what he was telling her in the dream, they shot the sequence in him in the dream saying what he said to her, but in her voice. It was really cool. It's a super short film. It's about the woman simply didn't die. She made a deal with the dark force, and the dark force said, you know, I have been working for you all these years. Now you're going to work for me, and I'll be back tomorrow. And so to get out of working for this malevolent spirit that she had been working for this whole entire time, she killed herself to try and get out of it. But the thing is, it's coming back tomorrow, and that's where I'll leave it. Like, it had the whole audience stunned. It was like a collective gasp because we didn't see the ending coming, and it came super fast. It was like getting hit in the face with a baseball bat. So absolutely, that one got 5 stars. After that was a film called 7 Minutes in Hell. And so this tells a story about a group of kids who break into an abandoned house that's supposed to be haunted. And it doesn't really look haunted because it just doesn't. It does look like someone hasn't lived there in a long time. It might be like going up for sale, but there's furniture in there. The windows aren't broken out. It just looks like maybe the house has been vacant for a while because it's like for sale, right? And so one of the girls is like, it's been vacant because, you know, someone died here. She's trying to make it spooky. They pull out a Ouija board. And one of the girls is like, come on, this is not like, this is scary. We're not supposed to be doing this. And then they decide to play a game called, it's a spin the bottle game called 7 Minutes in Heaven. And it's kind of like how when you spin the bottle and that's who you have to kiss. But if the whoever spins the bottle and whoever it ends up, instead of just kissing each other, you go into a closet for 7 minutes. And so when they go into the closet, they do realize that this fucking house is haunted. And what happens in this closet is actually hell in that house, because they shouldn't have been in the first place. And the force that haunts that house is much more stronger than these children. And you know what? I think children should not be going into houses that they think is haunted, because they probably are, right? And this absolutely, I don't want to tell too much about it, because I think that is now available on Altar, because it is making the rounds on the circuit. It is called 7 Minutes in Hell, and it's absolutely getting 5 stars. Next up is No Filter. Now, this movie is making the rounds in the film circuit. So I first saw this movie in the Grey Platt Film Festival that me and my co-host from Coast to Coast Horror, Lady Sasha, we reviewed that film live that night. And then I saw it again for one of the film festivals that I judge for, Crypticon, and then I got to see it again here at the Portland Horror Film Festival. Like I said, it is making the rounds. And this movie, even though I've seen it 3 times, it is still just as unsettling as it was the first time I saw it, because it is socially relevant, right? It's called No Filter. And this movie, the filter that they're using, every time you use it, it's augmented reality, but it really takes over your personality and turns you into something that you're not. First of all, the filter is drastic. It's not like a soft filter like from Snapchat or Instagram. It is like rock star makeup, and it gives you rock star confidence, and it absolutely changes the people who use the filter. And every time they use the filter, their clear skin gets all fucked up. And even though they know that it's harming them, they can't stop using the filter, because the filter has now taken over their body and soul, and they just can't stop using the filter until there's nothing left to give this filter. So like the first time and the second time, No Filter is getting 5 stars. The next movie is called Hellhole. And what I liked a lot about this movie, well, it's about a maintenance worker who is working in what he thinks is like an underground armament facility. And so one of the things that the way that it's shot is, the most of the movie is shot with a remote control car, and the set is miniature, and you can tell like when they have like the aerial shots, when you're looking down into the shaft, you can see like the little figurine of the maintenance worker with the little microphone, like the walkie-talkie. It's really cool the way that it's shot, because it's like the only real person, the only time we see a real person is when he's in the cab of the truck and the camera's right there. But the rest of the movie is in like stop motion, remote control, miniature set. So it was super cool. So this maintenance worker thinks he's working in like an underground weapons facility, but what's down there is much, much, much worse than weapons of mass destruction. Absolutely a super fun movie. It was one of the ones that got like the most cheers, and it is getting 5 stars because it was really fun. The next short was the one that I was like waiting for all night, and it's called In the Shadow of God. When I saw it in the program, I almost lost my damn ass mind. It is a religious horror. You guys know how I am, and it also blends in the occult. So this movie tells a tale about a young woman who's going home because they found her father dead. But once she gets home, she finds out that her father has died in really unusual circumstances. And whatever happened in his house affects everyone that goes there. So like the first night she wakes up in the throes of a nightmare after watching a home video of her father losing his mind, talking about how there's no one left in the house after his mother died. And so she has this like horrific nightmare. She's seeing her dad in like this contorted position. And when she wakes up after this nightmare, she's not in bed, but she's at the end of the driveway and there's a cellar with an open door. And so when she goes to the cellar, she hears what sounds like a baby crying. And at first she dismisses it and goes to the woods because she hears someone screaming into the woods. And so she goes to the woods and she goes to another house and she's looking up and this old couple, they jump off the roof at the same time, a double suicide. And so she calls the cops to report the death. And that's what connects the cop and the daughter, because the cop was the one who found her father. And from there, everything spirals out of fucking control and goes to hell in a handbasket fairly quickly. Whatever is happening in that cellar fucks everybody up that goes down there. So the next day when she wakes up again after the throes of a nightmare at the bottom of her father's driveway, in the foot of her of that cellar, after the police officer said, hey, you know, I don't know if you know how your father died, but we found him in the cellar and it looked like he was trying to claw his way out of it. And she was stunned by that because she did not have that information when they told her he died. So the cop was like, hey, I think you need to know this, you know, because he died under suspicious circumstances. Why was he down there? And she's like, I didn't even know we had a cellar. And so the next day when she wakes up, she hears a baby. And when she looks into the cellar, she immediately calls the cop, but he doesn't answer the phone. So she's given his partner, and she's like, hey, I called your partner, but I can't get a hold of him. And he's like, oh, they're having a family emergency. Their baby went missing last night and the Amber Alert just went out. And so when this cop looks into the cellar, as he's walking to the cellar, we find a baby blanket that's full of blood. We see the binky or the pacifier, depending on where you are in the country, here on the Pacific Northwest, mostly on the West Coast, we call those things binkies. The baby's binky is there. And so she immediately calls the police. And so when he goes into the cellar, he comes back out. He tells her to go into the house. He calls for backup. He goes into the cellar. And when she comes back out, because she doesn't see him, he is standing in front of the cellar and he's carved these very occultist symbols onto his arms, which is also in her father's home video and is in the house when she first walked in. And he turned around and he's like talking in a different language and he kills himself right in front of her. So like she's freaking out. But then she hears a baby crying into the cellar. So she goes to get what she thinks is a baby. Meanwhile, the cop who's child is missing, arrives on the scene, sees his dead partner. He hears a baby crying, but as he enters the cellar, he sees his baby's blanket, he sees his baby's binky, and he goes down there, and she's kneeling, and there's no baby crying. And he's like, turn around, you know, let me see what's in your hands. And she's like, I don't know what happened. And so when she stands up and turns around, she's holding a baby and the blanket is full of blood. And this man loses his mind because that's his kid. He drags her out of the cellar. He's demanding to know what happened. He's like, how could you do this? And then he's having flashbacks in his mind because his wife killed herself because their child was small, you know, like 2 or 3 months old. And so his baby is dead, his partner is dead, and he blows his head off right in front of her. And even though I told you a lot about this movie, it still will, you will not, it doesn't, like, you have to see it. Everything that I told you, even though it seems like a lot, it doesn't take away from, like, if you see this movie after watching this review. This movie was absolutely chilling. Absolutely 5 stars. It was one of the more darker shorts in this block. Like, it was just like, it gave what I was hoping it wanted to give. That was like really worth the wait. Speaking of dark films, I missed a short movie, so I need to go back to that. In the Shadow of God was the darkest movie in this set tonight, but the runner-up to that was Love You Mama. So this movie opens up on this girl who is grieving after the death of her father, and she is so distraught about what happened. She does not want to go outside anymore, and she doesn't want her mom to go outside anymore either. And she thinks that what happened to her father is her fault. And so through the movie, her mom is trying to encourage her to go outside, and the daughter is like, just order the food off the app. She's trying to tell her, it's so dangerous outside, you know, don't go outside. If something happens to you, I'm going to be all alone. And as the movie progressed, her urgency for her mother to stay in the house ratchets it up to the point where it's just really unsettling. And the mom is doing everything she can to encourage her daughter to go outside. And so the daughter decides to take the keys from her mom because, like, she told her mother to order the food on the app. And the daughter goes downstairs to eat dinner, and she's like, oh, the food finally arrived. And the mom's like, it didn't arrive. I went to go get it. And the daughter flips out. She's like, I told you not to leave the house. Why would you leave the house? And she's like, I don't like the app. I don't want to use it. And I'm not going to be locked up in the house. Like, you know, we can't control life. That what makes it so beautiful and so painful. And so the daughter takes her mother's keys. And so when the mom is ready to leave again, she's looking for the keys all over the place and finally finds them and leaves and comes back, you know, nothing happens. And so when the daughter comes back down for breakfast, you know, she's like, sits down and she's like, again, trying to tell her mom, it's too dangerous outside. I don't want you to leave. And the mom is like, you know, I don't know why you hid the keys. You knew I was going to find them anyway. And you cannot just stay down here. We have to, you know, live our lives. And as she's cutting up a zucchini, she cut her finger. And the mom jokes. She's like, oh my God, as much as I've been cooking, you would think I would know how to handle a knife, right? But the daughter says something that the mom missed. And it was one of the most chilling sentences in the whole entire movie. And she said, it's not even safe here. And this is when the movie takes even a darker turn. So her dad was remodeling the basement so that she could move into the basement. And when he was, when he had his accident and died, he had bought her a door with a lock because she wanted to be safe in the house and be protected. And he, you know, was like, see these guns, like, what else do you need protection for? And she just wanted a lock on her door. So he finally bought her a lock on the door, but he didn't make it home because he died in a car accident, right? So when she said that, you know, she's like, you know what, mom, I think I'm ready to move into the basement. And the mom's like, relieved that, okay, this is a step in the right direction. But no, what happens is we see that she's actually, this is where I'm going to stop, because I do believe that this movie is also available on Alter for you to see. Again, like I said, it's these two movies, Love You Mama and The Shadow of God, were the two darkest shorts of the night. Okay, so now that I'm back on track, the next short was called Smile. And so this movie is about a woman who is isolated from her family and we're listening to a message that she's getting from her mom. And her mom is like, hey, you know what? I just miss my daughter. I miss seeing you smile. And what we don't really understand the clues until the end of the movie, but like, she's taking medication and she doesn't answer her mom. And like, she sees like, throughout her night in isolation, every time there's a hint of a smile, there's something that happens. Like, we think it's an hallucination, and so does she. And so, but we're not really like thinking about that because we don't get the title to the end of the movie, right? And so she's like checking the locks and she's like thinking she's seeing things. She's taking her meds and she goes to bed. And as she's dreaming, she starts to smile in her dream. But that's when all of the things that we thought she was hallucinating, we find out she was not hallucinating it at all. And it was a monster that had like this giant, sinister, evil smile on its face. And so when she woke up realizing she was smiling, she couldn't stop smiling. And the monster pinned her to the bed. So it was kind of like being in sleep paralysis, but she couldn't move, right? And the monster made her smile more and more and more until her cheeks cracked and part of her skin fought, like was snatched off of her face. It was really gruesome and it was a really just like creepy short, and that one got 4 stars. This next one I think was a favorite. It was called Relax with Draco. And so we have this guy, he's like in a city, it's supposed to be New York. He gets coffee, he's like listening to his headphones as he's walking to work, and he sees this girl who's trying to put a bike chain on her bike. And so he offers to help. She's like, no, I got it. And he's like, you know what, I work at a bike shop, I can help you. And she's like, fine. But then she doesn't let him help. Like, she's like, you're doing it wrong. He's like, no, I got it. And as they're like tussling for the chain, she cuts her finger and it starts to bleed. And she's like, look at what happened. And then he freaks out. Like, he like jumps away from her. He puts his headphones on and he scrolls through his podcast until he finds a section called Relaxing with Draco. And when we listen to the podcast, we understand that this guy is a vampire, and the relaxation is so that he does not attack humans at the every sight of blood. But because this girl starts following him, demanding that he help her fix the bike, the relaxation tape doesn't work. It was a really fun, quirky movie that gets 3 stars. It wasn't really scary, but it was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. So the last short of the night was called While Mortals Sleep. And so we have an author who is going to hang out with a friend's house after her last publication caused a scandal. She is a true crime writer, and she wrote about a story without the parents, the victim's parents' permission, and she thought she was bringing closure. But what she did is she opened old wounds. So her publisher is like, hey, chill out for a couple of months and we'll like revisit your next book if you even still have a career. And she's like trying to tell him, I already have, you know, the idea of my next book. And he's like, you know what, this is not what we're talking about right now. So she gets to her friend's house and she calls again and she's like, hey, thank you again for letting me stay. Call me back. I don't understand why you're not answering my phone calls. So she's like in the house and she looks out the window and she sees some guy in the garden. So she goes outside and she's like, oh, hey, who are you? And he's like, well, the question is, who are you? Because you're the one who's trespassing. And she's like, actually, no, I'm a family friend. And so then a woman comes out of the house and she's like the gardener's wife. And she's like, hey, what's going on? And he's like, she says, she's a family friend. And they're like, oh, really? And so they tell her, you know, their house sitting, which doesn't make any sense because they were allowing their friend to stay at the house. So why would they need a house sitter, right? And as they're like talking, the author is like picking up on clues where these people are not who they say they are. And she hears a child crying and knowing that she's like, what's going on here? Like there shouldn't be a kid in this house. And she's thinking that maybe the child that is crying isn't theirs, right? And so this woman tells this unauthorized house sitter is like, you know what? You were just trying to change the world with your writing. You were trying to bring closure. I think you're a hero. She's like, but we're going to change the world too, and we want you to help us. Will you join us? And so thinking on her feet really quick, the author says, yeah, I'll help you. But what she did is she did that so that she could not raise suspicion. And as she followed the woman to see the baby, she picked up the knife by the cake. But when she saw the baby, that's when things got really, really, really dark. And I don't want to tell you too much more about that because I think this movie will be on altar soon. So that's While Mortals Sleep. It was a nice cosmic horror to close out the block, and it's getting 3.5 stars. So the feature for the night was really unsettling. It was called Woodland Gray.
I don't know how long I've been here, but I saw it. I don't know why I came, but it tortures me. I built that shed for it. All I know is that when it's inside there, it leaves me alone. I know that doesn't sound rational. I know that. I don't even know if you're real. Are you?
Are you at all curious what this is?
What I know is in constant flux.
This is impossible. This is my grandfather's.
I took this piece and I placed it in his coffin myself.
Oh, it's not real. It's not real. It's not real. Grandpa.
I need you to show me the way out of the woods.
I'm seeing things.
Never worked for me. Maybe better luck for you.
You're gonna be blindfolded because I can't have you direct people back here because of something you think that you saw.
What are you doing?
Don't move. Put your hands down. Put your hands down.
What is it? I know this makes me look like I'm a bad man, but I'm not. Not for this anyway.
And it's about a man who was living alone in the woods, and he finds a hiker who was injured, and he takes her back to his trailer to nurse her back to health. That was the plot of the movie. What I really liked about this movie is that from the very beginning, we don't really know what's going on. Like, we don't know if he's like a bad guy. We don't know we just don't know that much about him. What we do find out about what's going on in the woods near him before Emily, she's the one who was hiking in the woods and got injured. They're about maybe a mile or so away from his trailer is a black shed that has double locks on it. And he goes up there every day to put food underneath the hole for whatever's being held inside. So we don't know what that is, but we know that it's pretty dangerous because we don't just like lock things in a shed with double locks, right? So he's living his life. He's a quiet man, a simple man. That's my dog playing in the background there, if you hear that. And when Emily gets injured, she knocks herself unconscious and dislocates her knee. So he finds her. He carries her back to her cabin. It's very cold. And so he takes her coat off, her sweater off, wraps her in a blanket, puts her in bed, covers her up, dries out her clothes and sleeps outside. So when she wakes up in a trailer in the middle of the woods with the man that she doesn't know, of course she's like, oh my God, this can't be a good idea, right? So she's like, I think that I need to go to the hospital. And so he doesn't talk. So he's just like, he gestures to the door, like, I'm not holding you here. If you want to leave, you're free to leave, right? So she tries to leave, but her injuries suggest otherwise. And she's like, okay, I guess I'll stay. And so he tries to hand her like a warm drink, like in a tea mug. And she doesn't drink it because she's afraid of him. So like days go by where it's clear that he's not going to hurt her. He's really trying to nurse her back to health. And so once she realizes this, she's talking nonstop, like nonstop. And he's like, finally, he like snaps and he's like, you know what? You don't need to tell me every single thought that pops up into your head. I'm just a simple man. And this hurts her feelings. And she's like, you know what? Fine. And she storms off and she goes back into the trailer and goes to bed for the night. And he stays outside drinking. He has been sleeping outside ever since she's got there. And so after a night of drinking, he passes out. She's feeling well enough to try and hike. So when she comes outside and he's asleep, she covers him with a blanket. But then she hears whistling. So she goes to investigate the whistling and she finds the shed that has a double lock on it. And she looks inside and she sees what she thinks is a little girl. While she's looking in this shed, as she's approaching the shed, he wakes up, he goes to check on the injured hiker. She's not there. And he has a sinking feeling that he knows where she's gone. And right, he goes to check the shed and there she is peering inside. And what she thinks she sees is a child. Remember what she thinks she sees. So she goes crazy on this guy, like, how can you keep a child locked into a shed? And he's like trying to explain to her, that's not what this is. And they get into a fight and she plays dead because he's overpowering her. And he ties her up and he's taking her back to the trailer. But as he's carrying her, she attacks and she gets the upper hand and she ends up tying him up in his own trailer. And she's like, I'm going to go let her loose. And then I'm going to take her out of this woods and I'm calling the police. And he's like, please do not open this shed. And does she listen? No, she does not. She does not. And then of course she realizes he was telling the truth all along. My suspension of disbelief was not taken away from this at all. It's getting a 4.5 stars because one, I already knew that what was in that shed was not what it appeared to be. And as the movie unfolded, I started to kind of understand what was going on with that monster that had been unleashed. And there was nothing that, she wasn't doing anything that was like unreasonable. He wasn't doing anything unreasonable. Once they started to work together, because after she realized that she was wrong, then she started to be affected by this entity as well. And it just spiraled and spiraled as the movie went on and on. The scariness factor is getting a 4.5 stars because it is scary when the when they're trying to figure out if what they're seeing is really real. And then once you realize truly what's going on and why it's going on, once that opens itself over you, it just sends chills all the way down your back because you're like, oh my God, like, oh my God, it's crazy. It's so good, you guys. I absolutely love the ending, even though there was a bit of disagreement. I believe the ending, ending is explaining the movie one way, and then other people were interpreting it a different way. But I don't want to say too much because I don't want to give it away. But when you guys do see this movie, I want you to come back, leave me comments, and let me know what you thought this movie was trying to tell you, because I have a very specific idea of what's going on, and it just kind of blew me away. Who would like it? I think people who like slasher films, people who like suspense films, survival films, films with a strong female lead, films with a double twist ending, and films that have a karmic cycle that you have to get through in order to get to the next step. Like, it was just super really good. The stars for this one, you guys, is getting 4.5 stars. So that is day 3 of the Portland Horror Film Festival. Those are all the films that we watched tonight. I'm super excited about tomorrow. Tomorrow's a little different. We are doing matinees tomorrow morning. So I'm about to go to bed really quick so that I can get up and be all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed to get these movies reviewed for you tomorrow. And it's a short day. So we have, after the matinee, we're off for the rest of the night so that we can get ready for Sunday. So far this has just been a fucking blast. I'm so happy that I'm down here, and this lineup has just been incredible. So you guys, that's it for now, and I will see you on day 4.
To see.